The today's presentation. Actually, this topic I have modified a bit to include role duties and liabilities of directors and KMP. Though KMP was not part of the presentation, but now I feel that now there is no difference between you can say the role and responsibilities of a KMP and that of a director in the case of certain matters under the company law. So what means, since this is the, you can say, the bridge, pre-bridge course or a session, I was broadly aware that there will be some law students in the last year or the associates in the first year in the law firms or the company secretary firms. So professionals who are attending, it may be a bit basic, but I will be going to, you can say, basic to advanced as far as possible. So just, you can say, bit of patience may be required so that I can take along everybody in the session to cover all the aspects of the, you can say, the relevant provision that I'll be discussing. This discussion, though, in the presentation I've mentioned only, you can say, relevant provisions of the Act or the regulations. I will be discussing what are the nitty-gritties involved in that, what is the interlinking of certain provisions under the Companies Act with SEBI regulations, or within the provisions of the Companies Act. Since most of the audience will be law professionals, a very less of the compliance aspect will be discussed, or you can say the routine compliance aspect will be discussed. But wherever there is a complexity in the compliance, I will be discussing that as well. So I usually say that let's keep the session interactive in all the, you know, physical mode sessions. Yeah. So a bit of introduction that I've discussed. Yeah, key takeaways. I hope we discuss all the 3 points, and those are the key takeaways for you as participants. Yeah. Also, my views are personal, though I'm a part of the ICSI Managing Committee at Pune chapter. My views are personal, as well as if at all I'm mentioning any particular company or a case study or a case law, I'm... means whatever I have read till now, I am not associated with any of the case laws that are there, or anyone personally, but I have taken them as just as a case study, or you know what the principle has been laid down in these case studies. Yeah, so just the basics that we need to discuss, because this is quite relevant for all the students, maybe a few students who may be aware of certain provisions of the company law. A few practitioners who would have practiced more in Companies Act 1956. So let's discuss that. Now, if we see the definition of a director, director has been defined in the Companies Act, and not in a very, you know, in not a very different manner, but in a very clean manner. Or there is no doubt about who is a director, because that was the issue in the previous company law, that any person appointed by whatever name called was the way in which the director was defined in the previous law. Now this has been defined in the company law as a director means a director appointed by the company. So now there is an explicit provision or a clear provision that his appointment is to be is mandatory, and he should be a director of the company, or he should be appointed as a director of the company. Now we are already aware that there are executive director, non-executive director. So let's come to, you know, the definitions of it. Managing director has been defined in section 2. The crux of that section 2 or the definition is there are only two aspects in that definition. Is what are the powers given to the managing director, and second is how he is appointed. These are the only two things which are relevant from the perspective of who is a managing director of a company. So when we are saying about the mode of appointment, there are four ways in which he is appointed. Though this is section 2, we have to read in relation to the other provisions of the Act as well. So we have section 196 of the Act, which relates to the appointment of managing director, whole-time director, and a manager. So, but the basic definition says that he can be appointed by the memorandum of association, articles of association, a resolution passed by the board of directors, or a resolution passed by the shareholder. These are the ways in which he may be appointed. It may happen that the provisions of the memorandum would be silent. Articles may provide just a one-line provision that the company may appoint from time to time the managing director of a company. Then the board and shareholders appointment, or the appointment by them, depends on the provisions of section 196. As I said, I will not go into the details of the, you know, the procedural aspect, but we have to read these provisions. Basically, those are the documents. Say, for example, we'll be referring to the MCA circular. So MCA circular will be presented in the presentation itself. And then we have got the, I have compiled a few case laws about the director's liability under the securities law, so that we can be referring at that appropriate point of time. So you may either note down, or I can even share those documents with you all as well. So we have got the, so basically that is the, you can say the four ways in which a managing director is appointed. And then there is about the powers. And this is a very important aspect about the powers, that he has substantial powers of the management of the company. And what are substantial powers of the management of the company is not properly defined or codified. It has been defined in a negative manner. Like, these are not the substantial powers of the management. Like, you know, endorsing transfer of shares or signing checks, these are not powers of management. So something like representing the company, filing a case on behalf of the company, marketing on behalf of the company, or certain powers which he can exercise as investment, loan, guarantee, security. So these are the substantial powers that he can do for and on behalf of the board of directors, right? So when I say that these are substantial powers, they need to be codified in the manner in which he is appointed. So if he is appointed by a board resolution, the board resolution should provide the details of how he is appointed and what will be the substantial powers. It may happen that they may pass a board resolution, but those are given by way of a, by way of a power of attorney, or there could be an appointment letter. So there are ways in which we can give the substantial powers, but as law professionals, we have to ensure that there is substantial powers given to a person if he is appointed as a managing director. And I am also aware, and probably most of the professionals or the students would also be aware, that once you incorporate a company, the director himself portrays on all the social media that he is the managing director of the company. So you can, if you are connected to him or you are aware of that particular update, then you need to contact him and tell him that what are the, you know, ways in which you are appointed and how that can be regularized. Because there was a MCA or a DCA circular, Department of Company Affairs, the old company law, around somewhere in 1980 or 82, where the directors, where a person was not even a director of a company, but was uttering to the world that he is a director of the company. So MC had clarified that there is a necessity that he needs to be specifically appointed as a director of a company. So that amounts to misrepresentation. And therefore, I was saying about the social media by quite a few, now since it has been widely used. So that is one aspect. Now, whole-time director, this may again be a basic, but yes, whole-time director has been defined in the Act. A director who is in whole-time employment of the company, and that becomes relevant to us because that has now been defined. Now, under the previous company law, it was not defined. And there was one Bombay High Court judgment of Ramapen Thanawala. In that, there was one reference of who is the whole-time director. Actually, that judgment was in relation to managerial remuneration, but they had defined in just one line who is a whole-time director. But that was only the source in which you could know that who is the whole-time director of the company. But now it has been defined. Now the reference of whole-time director is given in the definition of an executive director. Executive director, though we say it in in our regular communication, executive director is not defined in the Act, but it has been referred to in the rules. So we have got the definition rules. In the rule 2, there is a reference to executive director. And executive director is now nothing but the whole-time director. So now there are just two types of directors when they are executive. Either it is the managing director or whole-time director or whole-time director or the executive director. So they are one and the same. It may happen that in certain companies, they appoint and it happens that he's director of sales, director of legal. So they are nothing but the whole-time director of the company, though you don't designate them as a whole-time director or a executive director in the company. So that is a slight difference between the two. Now, it may happen, and if at all this matter goes before the court, then probably it may be tested. That can a person who is a whole-time director be given substantial powers of the management, and whether he may be called as a managing director? Answer is yes, he will be called managing director, because in the definition of the managing director, at the end it says, by whatever name called, in section 2, subsection 54, and even if we refer to the definition of section 2, subsection 53 about the manager, it says by whatever name called. So substantial powers are very important. And there is one judgment which we will come to that judgment also of the Supreme Court, where it says probably even your role doesn't matter. Your designation doesn't matter. What your role is in the company, what powers you have got in the company, that matters for determining the liability. Now, the entire purpose that we are discussing all this is again going to the ultimate topic of who will be liable and who will be officer in default and how it will be interpreted. So non-executive directors, this has also not been defined. Non-executive directors, this has also not been defined, but it is nothing but a director who is not a managing director, whole-time director, executive director. So they are generally practicing professionals or consulting professional who have their expertise in the respective domains, and they are appointed by the company. If he is a family member, promoter group, then it will be a non-executive, non-independent director. And we have got section 149 CR, which speaks about the independent director. So there are criteria. There are criteria about shareholding and how he is connected to the company. So all these are the aspects with respect to the independent director. So non-executive directors, we'll come to one more. We'll be discussing that as well. But they are not in full-time employment. If we talk in the terms of who is officer in default, or if we talk in the terms of what is there in section 141 of the Negotiable Instrument Act, or under the Income Tax Act, or under section 27 of the SEBI Act, which talks about the liabilities. So there is a reference of a person or a director who is in charge of the management of the company. So without going into the facts, broadly, non-executive directors are not in charge of the management of the company, broadly. In a college, we have got a full-time faculty, and we also have got the visiting faculty. So the full-time faculty is something like an executive director. The principal is, you can say, the managing director, CEO, and the visiting faculty is the non-executive directors. So they just take a lecture and they are back. It is something like either meeting to meeting or a case to case. That is what is the role of the non-executive director. Now, we appoint, or we have directors who are appointed as additional director, alternate director, and casual vacancy. These are not types of directors, and never misunderstand this. These are just the ways in which they are appointed. Right? So additional director is appointed by the board. Alternate is also, means all three are appointed by the board, but for a different purpose, a temporary purpose, or you can say a stopgap arrangement is there. Ultimately, these matters go to the shareholders of the company. Then resident director and woman director, these are also the provisions in section 149. And there are criteria about the resident director. But again, a resident director can be an executive director, non-executive director. And woman directors as well, it can be an executive, non-executive, independent or non-independent. So these are, as I say, it is something like, you know, types of companies and classes of companies. Similarly, we have got types of directors and classes of directors. So all what we are discussing are classes of directors now, right? And then we have got a nominee director. Nominee director here, though it has not been defined, it has been defined as a director nominated by financial institutions, by an agreement or appointed by the government or any other person to represent its interest. AMPs, CEO is also defined, and we have also got the CS of the company, the whole-time director and the CFO. And interestingly, by the Companies Amendment Act 2017, this provision has been amended. And they have introduced to even one line below the board to be the KMPs of the company. And it has been further kept to the delegated legislation to have any other officer. But if we refer section 203, the provisions with respect to clause E that is any other officer below, one level below the board, is not defined, or there is not, they have not provided for that. And also, if we see the combination, the CEO, managing director, and the manager, the combination in section 203 is a different combination. However, section 2, which relates to the key managerial personnel, this provision is a general provision which applies to any company, whether a private company or a public company. And when it comes to a specific applicability of section 203, there is a reference of, you can say, a listed entity, a company with a prescribed paid up capital or a turnover. So those provisions are there. So this is about the key managerial personnel. Yeah, so the reason that we discussed the KMP was only one that we discussed in detail, or at least there is a reference in the officer in default provisions with respect to the KMP. If we see the provisions of officer in default, there is no reference of a managing director at all. So there is a reference of a whole-time director. There is a reference of a KMP, which we just discussed earlier. And in the two slides that we have for the officer in default, there is no reference of a managing director. So therefore, you can say the observation that we are taking, that the managing director is included in the KMP, which applies to any company, whether a private company or a public company, at that point of time, he will be considered as a KMP and will be liable for the penalty, punishment, or imprisonment, or fine, or otherwise, for the following officers of the company. And when there is no KMP or a direct such director who has given consent to be the officer in default, this happens in quite a few companies where there are certain plants or there are certain operations which are delegated to a particular person. He may not be the director of the company, or he may be a director or a very, very, very senior person. So even that person can be appointed as the officer in default. Now, when we discuss the MCS circular, we will be discussing this aspect as well. The MCS circular of the 2nd March 2020 that was released very recently. Yeah. So we go to the next slide. Yeah. Then it says any person under the immediate authority of the board who is in charge with any responsibility. If you see this particular clause, just to, you know, think it very loudly, it may happen that maybe an accounts department, finance department, or a legal department may fall under, or the employees in these departments may fall under this, because they are in, you can say, they have the responsibility of accounts records authorities, or they are authorized, they actively participate or knowingly prevent if it fails to take the steps in case of default. So I'm not generalizing, but that is what is the impact of the officer in default definition. If we see the next two clauses mostly speaks about advice or directions or instructions given by the board of directors. So and they are accustomed to act. So it is something like a person is not on the board, but he is giving instructions to the person and operations are operating like that. This concept, though mentioned over here in these two clauses, this concept is actually defined in the English Companies Act as shadow directors. And these shadow directors are basically directors who are not on board, but still have got influence over the company and the board. And last is, if we see, interestingly, it includes completely a third party. That includes the share transfer agent and the merchant bankers. So if at all there is a non-compliance, and in case of a listed entity, if these entities are appointed, and in case of unlisted public companies, now that we have got Rule 9A, which is applicable, so these may also be considered. But in the last point, these are body corporates. So that is one legal issue which will be there. Because when you say officer in default, it is usually a person. And when we are talking about the last clause, they are generally in the form of body corporates or entities. So that could be difficult though as of now, I have not seen that this has been tested under the Companies Act. Under the securities law, quite a few action have been taken against these securities market intermediaries, but not under the Companies Act. Now, though I have not discussed one point, but there is also a reference of an officer. And the reference of the officer, which is there just before the definition of officer and default, I will just read out that part. It says, an officer includes a director, manager, KMP, or any other person in accordance with whose directions or instructions the board of directors or any one or more directors is or are accustomed to act. Now, the reason that I'm referring to this definition is because there are quite a few provisions under the SEBI PIT regulations 2015 and even 1992, there was a reference of the term officer, because there are certain obligations under regulation 13 of the previous law and this under this 2015, where there is an obligation on the officer to make certain disclosures, whether he will be he'll be falling under the class of person of designated employees and all. So all these aspects are there. And there are two judgments of SAT clarifying the position of who is an officer of the company. Though it is not part of the presentation, but that is one important aspect with respect to the office. Yeah, so broadly, now we come to the duties. Now, there is a specific provision with respect to duties. For the first time, we have this provision in the Companies Act. Earlier, they were through various case laws, through judgments, that these duties were there, but now it has been codified. So directors have to ensure that they comply with the articles of association. They act in good faith. They promote the objects. If you see the clause two, generally when we are talking about corporate governance, we always say whether it is related to only shareholders or stakeholders, or to what extent we say the stakeholders. This clause two is so wide that it will include even the stakeholders, which will include the community and the protection of environment. And directors shall exercise their duties with reasonable and due care. We will be referring those with certain case laws that we'll be discussing just after this. And interestingly, most of these provisions which are there in section 166, there is a reference, there are quite a few references to the other provisions. For example, we come to the next point, which says that the director shall not involve in a situation that he may directly or indirectly have a conflict of interest with the interest of the company. Now, to mitigate this particular conflict, we have a separate provision of section 184, which relates to the disclosure of interest by the director. So we will be discussing that as well. And we will be discussing clause by clause what are the relevant provisions, because they are ultimately the duties of the director. So we can come to the next point or next slide. Yeah, he shall not achieve or attempt to achieve any undue gain or advantage. This is again, this clause is again an outcome of section, or the outcome is section 184, which relates to the disclosure, and section 188, which relates to the related party transaction. Earlier point was about the, just disclosures or conflict of interest. And now we actually mitigate that conflict of interest or ensure that the director doesn't take undue advantage. So when we are reading these provisions, we have to read the provisions in light of section 166 and the relevant provisions. He shall not assign his office, because this generally happens that a director is not appointed, but the director is appointed, he doesn't act on behalf of the company, and the office is assigned either in the form of duties or in the form of remuneration. So broadly, these are the cases. But if we see the penal provisions are not that much if we don't comply. Actually, they have codified it so much that ultimately this is so very relevant for the directors that it cannot be just 1 lakh or 5 lakh as a penal provision. But anyways, since probably we are moving towards decriminalization, this could be one of the aspects which was already incorporated in the Companies Act. Okay, we move to the next point, the next slide. Yeah, so since we are on section 166 and we were discussing on the duties, there are certain obligations and duties which have also been mentioned under the SEBI LODR. If we refer to Chapter 2 and Regulation 4, they have mentioned certain duties. Now, if we see just a very basic principle when we are reading the provisions of the company law or corporate law, wherever there is a reference of a company, at that point of time, there is a provision under section, there is a provision in the Company Act, section 179, subsection 3, or 179, subsection 1, which says that a company, whatever a company can do, the board of directors shall be, you can say they have got the same authority. So there are certain provisions where activities are to be done by the company, but it ultimately means the board of directors. So in certain cases, we can say that company, the term company can be substituted by the term board of directors. So when I say that there is a reference of entities in the SEBI LODR, and it says that the entity should disclose, entity should do that, entity should maintain a policy, at that point of time, it actually means that it is the board of directors who should do it. So just coming precisely to section 179, so that there is no much not much confusion, I'll just quickly refer that section 179, subsection 1. It says that the board of directors of the company shall be entitled to exercise all such powers and to do all such acts and things as the company is authorized to do, authorized to exercise and do. And the provisions then proviso introduces certain conditions that these actions can be taken within the limits of the Memorandum Article Act and a resolution passed by the shareholders. So the ultimate objective of discussing this is that if at all there is an obligation on the company, it is ultimately the obligation of the board of directors. So information shall be prepared in accordance with the applicable accounting standards of the accounting and financial disclosures. Yeah, I've just copy pasted. We'll be discussing at a relevant point of time. Accounting standards, or the emphasis of this SEBI LODR is also on the accounting standards and the way in which the books of accounts are prepared. They shall ensure that the annual audit is conducted by an independent and a competent qualified auditor. So though this is routed through the audit committee, still it is the board of directors or the company that should ensure the same. Point number four for misrepresentation. This is also very important from the perspective of the rights of shareholders. So there are quite a few rights that this chapter two evolves the rights of the shareholders. This is also quite relevant. So refrain from representation and information provided to the stock exchange and investor is not misleading. Though there is one single line in SEBI LODR, we have got PFUTP regulations which regulate the aspect with respect to the manipulation of share price as well as misleading disclosures by the company to the stock exchange. So there is a reference in both the regulations. Yes, adequately and timely information to the stock exchanges and investors. This is specifically, we will be discussing this when we discuss Clause 30 because it ultimately the duty of the directors. But there was a very recent case, or there are quite a few cases that are going on this aspect of timely information to the stock exchange. Yeah, dissemination that is required. This is very, very, in a very crude language, it says, or maybe in a very objective language, it says that it is adequate, accurate, explicit, timely, and presented in a simple language. So just imagine so much of obligation on the compliance officer to make it very simple for all the stakeholders. So channels of disseminating information should be equal, timely, and cost efficient. So these are certain points which are there. Yeah, we come to the next slide. Yes, now we come, so basically by discussing section 166 and LODR, we come to the next point with respect to the duties of director. And this duty I've specifically included because very few professionals are actually aware that this is the duty of a director and not the duty of the shareholders or the promoters or the subscribers to the Memorandum of Association. If we see section 10A, that was introduced by the Companies Amendment Act 2019, first by the ordinance, it says that you can say a company shall not commence business, company with share capital, or exercise borrowing power unless two conditions are met. First is the declaration is filed by the directors that the subscribers have introduced the money in the company as per the subscription agreement, as per the subscription to be memorandum of association. And secondly, it says that the company has filed with the registrar a verification at the registered office. And then there are penal provisions. Now, actually, if we see that declaration is supposed to be given by the director of the company, so he has to ensure that the adequate money has been received in the bank account. Now, this will be very crucial, specifically in relation to subsidiary companies or joint venture companies which are incorporated, where the shareholders are different and the directors are different, or shareholders are in a body corporate form or and the director. So, therefore, this is very crucial. Generally, it may happen that money is received a bit in excess or it is less, and we file declarations. So this is a very crucial aspect. And if there is a default in this particular non-compliance, it is the first non-compliance of the director and then the non-compliance of the shareholder, if that is the case. So these two are, this is a very important aspect which comes out of the duties of the director. And ultimately, in certain cases, as law professionals, we are only the person who are aware of all this. We have to ensure this aspect when it comes to the duties of the director. Yeah, so as we discussed earlier with respect to the conflict of interest, this is one aspect which I would like to discuss. And there are, it is not a very clear provision as it may look, section 184 of the Act. And I personally feel that whether it is conflict of interest, whether it is a related party transaction, whether it is a non-compliance, whether it may be siphoning of funds, everything has got its roots to section 184 of this Act and section 299 of the previous Act. And we had section 86 of 1913 Act, which all talked about disclosure of directors. And virtually it means, or the broad conclusion of this section 184, in my view, is that wherever director is interested at any point of time, just disclose it to the company, whether he is a director, shareholder. Shareholder is quite debatable, but even as a director, or it can be, he may be a trustee in a trust or a society, or in any capacity that he may be there, disclosure would be the best way, because that is what is the intention. And I will be referring to maybe one or two case laws in relation to the disclosure as well. So he shall disclose his concern or interest, and in the body's corporate, in the body's corporate firms or any other association of individual which include the shareholding. So these are very, very broad and wide terms. It says concern or interest. It has got undefined terms as a firm. It has got an undefined term, which is an association of person. So all this is not very clear. So it is desirable that adequate disclosure made by the board of directors. And now there are two, this is section 184, subsection 1. And generally it is called as the general disclosure, because it is general disclosure by the director and there is not a specific transaction based disclosure. Okay, so that is, these are two separate things. Section 184, subsection 1, general disclosure. Section 184, subsection 2, specific disclosure or transaction specific disclosure. And we will come to whether if you disclose under subsection 1, whether it is an adequate disclosure under subsection 2. So when it says about what is to be disclosed, it says when it is to be disclosed. It says first board meeting where he participates as a director, at a subsequent board meeting, and whenever there is change in the disclosures, it says then at the first board meeting after such change. The purpose that I'm discussing is that when we say these three points or the occasions of disclosure, it actually speaks about meetings. So such disclosure can be only made at a board meeting, whether it is conducted virtually through video conferencing or in a in-person meeting. So just take an example. A director has been interested in a particular transaction or in a company, and he has not made disclosure because the board meeting is not there immediately. And however, he emails it to the chairman saying that I am a person who has got very recently appointed as a director or in some capacity, and therefore this aspect is to be considered. But interestingly, that may not amount to a specific disclosure under section 184, subsection 2. So what I mean to say, the disclosures are to be given only at a board meeting. Right? So this is, you can say, a very important aspect, because in quite a few companies or in quite a few group of companies, there could be certain directors who are appointed, or there is a change in the management or restructuring that is taking place. And this becomes a very important aspect. So please understand, there are three points where general disclosure is made. First, when he is appointed. Second, in the second that he discloses at the start of the financial year. And third, where there is any change in his disclosure that he has already made. So this speaks about the specific disclosures. Specific disclosures is in relation to the contract or arrangement. Now, just the way we had got, you know, concern or interest. Now, there were two undefined terms. Now, in this, there are four undefined terms or six undefined terms. So it says every director of a company who is in any way directly or indirectly concerned, interested, contract or arrangement. So there is one judgment of the Bombay High Court in the Firestone case, where they had Firestone Tire. I will share the citation if required. But it is a very celebrated case which talks about the importance of disclosures under Section 299 under the previous Act. It says that the purpose that these have been kept open and undefined is because even the law cannot codify and specifically say that this is to be disclosed and this is not to be disclosed. It means that anything where a director is interested. Now, this interest is also very interesting. At least I feel it is interesting. I hope I'll make it interesting for you as well. So whether this interest is a financial interest, whether it is a beneficial interest, whether maybe a pecuniary interest, or it could be, you know, a nominal interest, right? Just take an example. There is a wholly owned subsidiary that is formed and you need two shareholders. So there is 99% shares held by the parent company and one share is held by another person and he is holding it as a nominee. But where the question would be whether you have to disclose this to the company where you are already appointed as a director, that you are now a nominee shareholder. Nominee means, I mean to say, you can say the beneficial interest is not with me, but I'm just a namesake shareholder in the company, the second shareholder in the company. So these are the critical ways, right? So whether an interest is created, whether he may not be interested, but whether it is a concern or whether it is a contract. Arrangements are generally where there is no specific contract, but there is understanding between the parties. Right? So there are this subsection to those specific. It is speaking about the wider concepts of disclosure and interest. Now the next confusion is that they have codified who they are, right? So they have codified, which actually should have not been the case in the section 299 previous Act. These two clauses were not there and they were very clear. But now anyways, we have these two clauses and it creates a confusion, because here it says about, you can say, a body corporate in which a director or so director is in association with any other director, or it says a firm or an entity and he's an owner or a partner. There is one aspect which is there, that if at all in the interim time he gets concerned or interested, then he shall inform it in the next board meeting that he attends that he is interested. See, there is no restriction on the, you can say, the director, that he can disclose this in the interim time, but he needs to make a formal specific disclosure in that board meeting. So this is a very, very important thing. The reason is, if we don't comply about giving disclosures, whether a general disclosure or a specific disclosure in the board meeting, then the consequences, though there are monetary consequences or penal consequences, the outcome is ultimately in section which relates to the vacation of office of director. So we have to ensure that adequate disclosures are made by the... There are some questions, and I'm aware, just now moving from the basic to a bit practical aspect. There are certain directors who don't want to disclose their interest or concern. And it may happen that certain directors are not closely associated with their family members to understand their interest. Maybe there is a rift between brothers maybe the sister and brother are not communicating on a regular basis. So there could be ways or there could be reasons where they may not communicate. But ultimately, this is the responsibility of the director. So he needs to take a call about the disclosures. Second is whether the, you know, the general disclosure is adequate, or can the, you can say, whether specific disclosure is required to be made. So if we refer this section 184 with section 299, it is necessary. In 299, there was a provision which says that if you make a specific disclosure, you make a general disclosure. There was a provision to that effect. But now we don't have. So considering this, these two disclosures are now two distinct separate compliances for the companies and specifically for the director. So these are two separate things that are to be complied. I have few case laws on these aspects, but they are mostly from the perspective of the rationale, purpose, and of this particular provision. But maybe I may share the citations in the PPT later on, and that can be shared with the participants. Because we means I was not aware of the. Yeah, we have some more time. So really, we always say to the director that, you know, you have to attend one board meeting in 12 months. But that is coming out of one provision which is related to the vacation of office. And if he absents himself for all board meetings during 12 months without seeking leave of absence, then he vacates the office. Now, question is that from where you count the 12 months? Whether you count that 12 months from the last attended meeting or the next called board meeting, right? So this could be a legal issue, but in my view, it will be the next called board meeting. Just an example, the board meeting was called in the month of April 2019. And since then, he has not attended, a director has not attended a meeting, whether in a private company or a public company. And in May 2020, not in April 2019, April 2020, but in May 2020, the meeting was called. The next meeting means in the meantime also there were meetings, but he didn't attend the meeting. After, say, January 2020, the next meeting was called in April 2020. So he, or May 2020. So the person will vacate the office from the meeting which he ought to have attended for completing the period of 12 months. This is debatable, but that is how we have to calculate, or we have to make the directors aware. So there are two things to this particular presentation. One is about educating directors and discussing with law professionals. Because when we law professionals or corporate law professionals discuss, there could be a different aspect to the discussion as well. So I am just aware of it. Now, interestingly, leave of absence has become redundant for the purpose of vacation of office. This had a significance in Section 283 of the old Act, but not under the present provisions. And these were the two provisions that I was referring to. Inadequate disclosures or a contravention of Section 184, there is vacation of office of director. So whether he contravenes the provisions or fails to disclose, it will amount to a vacation of office. So generally, the directors ask that, suppose if I don't disclose, then what is going to be happen? What is going to happen? You can tell that this is the consequence of the non-disclosure. Yeah. So this is director's responsibility statement. What I have tried to do is, duties of director other than Section 180, say 166, the duties of director are, you know, dispersed in the Act. So wherever the directors are made responsible, liable, I have referred to the relevant provisions. And yes, those are the provisions that have been mentioned. So again, there is a reference of accounting standards, accounting policies that they have to apply, and they have taken adequate care and sufficient care in the assets of the company. We can come to the next slide. Yeah, this is a very important aspect, specifically in the present scenario about the going concern, because now directors have to specifically mention that it is a going concern basis. So in the present scenario, because of the business being affected, this has an impact. And in the present director's responsibility statement, directors can elaborate in the director's report about the going concern, if at all they have got concerns. But there is a specific requirement that they mention this. The next clause about the internal financial controls only for listed entities. And the last clause is the point which is very relevant for corporate law professionals because it speaks about the you know, the company has devised a system for complying with all the applicable laws. So it is practically not possible for a company to ensure the compliance of all the applicable laws on a regular basis. So there could be a way in which that they can do. Either it can be done by the board of directors collectively, or the company secretary or the legal head, or together, that they can ensure the compliance of all the laws. But the directors are specifically required to give the certification in the director's report. So this is very crucial. It may be, so we have to find out the applicability of the laws. It may be a law where we have not even studied in detail, or we are just aware of that law. Interestingly, to give you an example, even the compliance of the MHA guidelines, circulars, notification that they have issued, compliance of all the social distancing norm in the company, even that will fall under the provisions of this particular point, which says about the applicable laws. So it is an ever-evolving, it is just like any legal course that we have that the company is required to have. This is for the first time that they have introduced this in the Companies Act, which has an impact on a private and a public company as well. So very critical, and practically directors cannot just give a very, you know, a random statement that yes, we are complying with all the laws, unless and until they have ensured the compliance. Now, to give you a practical side of this particular point, generally the company secretary and the legal officer or the legal head, whoever is in charge of this compliance, they give a quarterly presentations to the board, and that is taken on record, and based on that they may certify this. But this happens in a very formal structure where they have got these resources. In other cases, they may have certain consultants for such kind of compliance. Yeah, now we come to the point with respect to the disclosure of events under the LODR regulation. And I will just refer to few points where it says about listed entities shall make disclosures which in the opinion of the board of directors are material. And then there is a point with respect to the policy, and there are list of events which are deemed to be material. And there are points where they have to specify the criteria with respect to the materiality of the event. So we come to the next point. Yeah, so this is about the formulation or framing of a policy. Now, with this point about the next point about the determining the materiality of the event. Now, they have specifically mentioned, at least in the regulation that they have mentioned, that they should authorize one or more KMPs for the purpose of determining the materiality. But under the previous listing agreement, erstwhile listing agreement, there was no reference as such to the, you can say, a specific person. So it was entire board that was responsible. Now, to give you one very, you can say, a relevant reference over here, in the case of the SAT judgment of NDTV, and this case related to the provisions prior to 2015, the issue was that NDTV had received an income tax notice from the income tax department, and it was a bit higher than the net worth of the company. So the issue was whether this is to be disclosed to the stock exchanges under the listing regulation. Under the listing agreement. So based on the relevant provisions, the SEBI issued a notice that this is a material information which affects the existence of the entity. So it is required to be disclosed. Then the matter was appealed, it went SAT. And that time it was, SEBI had levied a penalty on the company and the compliance officer for the non-compliance. And at that point of time, in that judgment, SAT had specifically mentioned that compliance officer is working under the directions of the board of directors, and therefore, it will not be appropriate for the company to the SEBI to impose the penalty on the compliance officer. And therefore, that point with respect to the non-disclosure was only on the company. But obviously, the law has changed. And when it comes to KMP, it can be a collective responsibility of two or more persons. And in the earlier point, there was a reference of the materiality and to be disclosed immediately. Now, what is immediately and what is forthwith is also being discussed in the SAT judgment of NDTV. So any participant is interested, he can refer that. It is of 2019, last year only. So you can refer that judgment. And I had also authored a very detailed article on that reporting of the information on a immediate basis. Because what is immediate and how immediate, you know, whether 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 30 minutes, so there are pointers to it and they have discussed its importance and relevance. Yeah, there was one more judgment. This was in the very recent judgment of SAT. This was in the case of ICICI Bank when they acquired the shares from the acquired the share of Bank of Rajasthan, and that was one of the cases also discussed. And they have disclosed they have discussed the importance of disclosures. And the issue was the executive director of ICICI Bank had acquired some majority shares of the promoters of Bank of Rajasthan for and on behalf of ICICI Bank. But the event was not disclosed specifically at that point of time. They have discussed the timeline also in the event, in the order, but it was a slight delay. So the question was whether that slight delay and all those points were discussed. So whenever you get an opportunity, you can also read that, because generally it is said that this disclosure related, when to disclose is the question, and how much to disclose is also the question. And these two points have been discussed in the judgment. Now, obviously, they had argued that the transaction was not complete and it was subject to due diligence and many other things. But obviously, SAT has given its own observations, and they are quite relevant for us because we are usually dealing with the management on this aspect. Yeah. So there are some procedural aspects about the mentioning of contact details of the professionals, personnel on the website. Yeah. So resignation of the director. So you may ask that if he is resigning, then what is the question of the liability? But interestingly, there is a reference of liability in the definition in section 168 of the Act. First few points are very clear that he may resign in writing. And there are a few pointers to it and checklist to it. That's fine. Then the director may also forward his resignation with detailed reasons, but now it is made optional to the directors. There is DIR 11 that is to be filed. Resignation shall take place either from that particular date or the next day, whichever he mentions in the notice. And the last point is relevant, which speaks about the liability. It says director who has resigned shall be liable even after his resignation for the offenses which occurred during his tenure. So this is a very relevant aspect and quite important for us to know, because we have to make him aware that even if you are resigning for whatever reasons, you will be liable. Just to give you one more reference, because we are on the resignation as well. Yeah, under the Income Tax Act, there is a specific provision which says about liability in the case of private companies. Liability of directors of private company. It says that the director, if the company is not, you can say it can pay the liabilities, then it will be the director who will pay, who the director at that point of time. So there was one Gujarat High Court judgment where it was a public company, but a closely held public company, and there was a liability, and there was one person who was the managing director of the company. And he was running the company just like a private company or a sole proprietary. And there were certain liabilities. There were TDS that was to be deducted and deposited, but certain tax compliances were not met. And the question in that issue in the case was that, the income tax office had issued a notice to the company saying that the director is liable to be, director is liable to pay all this. They filed a writ saying that since this is a public company and all, he is not eligible to pay, or he is not liable to pay, and therefore you can say it should be recovered only from the company. The point that I'm making is there are two things. First, it was a public company, but still the Gujarat High Court held that it will be the director who will be liable because it was run like a private company, and they took into consideration many factors about decision making, board minutes, and the meeting document, the decision making that was done. That was one. And second is, in spite of the director being resigned from the, even though he had resigned from the company, still he was made liable for the non-compliances and non-payment of taxes for the public unlisted company. So what I mean to say is that this is not only to be considered from the resignation perspective, but also from other perspective. Like for example, a under section 141 case, if there is a of the negotiable instrument, then if a check has been issued, even that point will be considered because he was in charge of the management of the company when the default took place. Right? So all these are very critical points, and resignation is critical in certain cases. Yeah. So we come to the next point. Which is section 149, subsection 12. This is very critical, and probably most of the participants would be aware of it. But it says that notwithstanding, this is part of the appointment of directors. Just below independent directors, there is a reference of section 149, subsection 12. It says, notwithstanding anything contained in this act, the independent director and non-executive director shall be liable only in respect of the acts of omission or commission by the company which had occurred with his knowledge attributable through the board process. And this is the point which is to be highlighted, very important and very critical, and we need to deliberate on this. We'll come to this. And it says, and with his consent or connivance, or where he had not acted diligently. There are only, in my view, three, 4 points to it. First, it says certain class of directors are not liable. First, second is they should, that compliance or non-compliance or omission or commission, the case in this particular subsection, that should be specifically attributable to the board process. This is quite relevant, and practically there is no detailed guidance on what is a board process. Okay, so I will give you some reference to this aspect of board process, and we can deliberate also. And it says that he has not acted diligently. Exercising diligence is a very important aspect. And we will come to this point as well. So we will discuss 2 points. First is the board process, and second is acting diligently, or the diligence, exercising diligence. So when it says board process, just take an example for today's webinar. You had received a notice of the meeting. You had an opportunity to register and attend the meeting. Then probably you may have the notes of the meeting, which are the minutes of the meeting, right? And just take an example. There are certain things right from the notice of the meeting till the minutes of the meeting. You are receiving all this, and you are a party to this transaction. But, and there are, you can say there are certain things that have not taken place properly in this meeting, legally that have taken place. I mean, not the webinar, but take an example. It is a board meeting, right? So if that is the case, but still you have kept quiet and you said that, okay, chalne do, anyways, I have not attended the meeting, or I have attended the meeting, but I am saying that, okay, it is the managing director, full-time director who will check the same. That point of time, I was a part of the board process and I have not acted diligently. So these are the 2 things. So I will be liable even if that I am an independent director or a non-executive director, or not being a promoter or the KMP. So these are very, very critical points that are there in the case of the liabilities that are to be determined. Board process is not defined, but in my view, it will be the receipt of agenda to the minute. And if you see the minutes, section 118 provisions, read with the rules, and even the standards, there is a requirement that the draft minutes should be circulated. Even in the present scenario of video conferencing through board meeting, there is a requirement of circulating this. So as a director, you have to ensure that the points about diligence are taken into consideration for that particular director. I would just like to bring one case so that we can move on to the next point. There was a SEBI order in the case of Zilog Systems Limited. And there were some defaults made by the company with respect to payment of dividend, some payment to the shareholders, and redemption of certain bonds. Means I'm not specifically aware, but there were 2 main defaults. First is with respect to non-payment of dividend on time, and second was with respect to the depositing the TDS with the banks, the income tax authorities. So these were the 2 main defaults. Which were discussed in the order. But at that point of time, the independent directors exercised diligence and flagged this off to the board of directors, ensured that they have been incorporated in the minutes of the meeting, and ensured that, and those who were present, because they had exercised diligence and they had flagged company management, the directors of the company. So in relation to this specific points, there are some very recent judgments or orders of SEBI or SAT where you can just check with respect to the board process or the diligence. One thing I would like to suggest, maybe because of paucity of time, I am not able to discuss that. If you actually want to understand what is diligence, exercising diligence, then it is not required to, you know, you may not get a direct case law for exercising diligence by the director. What I mean to say is that about diligence, you will get certain case laws in securities law, which in my view will be relevant even under section 149, subsection 12. Yeah, this one point that I wanted to discuss was about section 27 of the SEBI Act, because this becomes relevant specifically in relation to non-compliances under the securities law. It says that in case of contravention of the Act, so all SEBI orders or any action taken by SEBI is all under section 27, because it is contravention by the companies. It says every person who at the time of contravention was committed was in charge and was responsible to and the company for the conduct of the for the business of the company as well as the company shall be deemed to be guilty of the contravention and liable to be proceeded against and punished accordingly. So this is the very relevant aspect about section 27. But it says every person. But the next point is again about the knowledge, omission, commission and diligence. So here, due diligence. So here is the relevant point. In my view, in quite a few cases, which I will be discussing part of the presentation, is there they have given a reference to these case laws, specifically in relation to section 27, read with section 149, subsection 12. And in the recent cases, in just 2019-2020, these judgments are there. So yes, these are correlated. This is what it actually says about contravention with respect to the consent or connivance. So it is a bit similar to section 149, subsection 12. Bit similar. Anyways, we come to the next slide. So this is the circular. I just want to highlight few things in the circular. Yeah, because this circular, you know, I couldn't include it in the PPT. So I just thought of mentioning over here. They have given a good background to this circular. And believe me, this is not the first time that the MCA has issued this kind of a circular. As far as I remember, this circular was issued in 2011. It was also issued in 2005. It was issued in 2000 or maybe 1999. And just before that, there have been various occasions where MCA has issuing circular specifically with respect to the prosecution or internal adjudication against the directors of the company. Because though independent directors concept has come later, still the circulars were issued by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs specifically in relation to the non-executive directors. So here it says about how the operations of the company generally are conducted, and there could be so first para gives a good point. There was a reference of GNL3, and that I was referring to a person who was appointed as a officer in default, and that point was there. Now we come to a very relevant point which has been highlighted here. It says that under that they have referred to the relevant provision that we just discussed. So independent directors and non-executive directors, they should not be arrayed in the criminal or civil proceedings under the Act. So please understand, this is specifically only for Companies Act. But other provisions have also got similar provisions, which is there of the circular. So it says, apart from the independent directors, non-executive directors, I'm not able to read it, but yeah. So it says about these directors. So nominee directors for the government companies or PSUs, public sector financial institutions, or the lending institutions, or directors who have been appointed. So nothing will be, no criminal action or a civil proceeding will be initiated against these directors to start with. At least this is the introduction part. So the nature of the default is very crucial in this aspect, and all the instances of filing the records with the registrar, please understand, ministry will go through all what we have filed with the ministry, with the ROC, and based on that, they will be issuing the notice. Therefore, as I told you, when we are saying a person is appointed as an executive director, non-executive director, so when we are filing e-forms, it is very crucial that how we are appointing, and you know, there are technical challenges as I understand, but you know, that apart, we have to be very clear when we are appointing a director. Generally, I ensure that, you know, that our director's appointment, either are they give it in the email, or there is some way in which they inform me of how they are appointed. As consultants, we cannot presume that this is the way in which a director is appointed, or wo executive hoga, wo non-executive hoga. So that is not a correct way, because ultimately we are deciding the fate of the director with respect to the liability. So we have to be very clear on that. I, even for a very small private company where there is full compliance, I ensure that at least one page letter of appointment is given to the executive and non-executive director, even though there is a complete understanding, because and every at least once in 6 months I keep them practically. I send an email saying that if there is change in your directorship, whether executive or non-executive, please keep us posted. We will take forward the next complaint. So we have to, because practically the directors will not understand these provisions and how they may be liable. So what I mean to say that information records, registers, statutory registers, minutes, notices issued or the orders issued by the statutory authority, including NCLT, all are taken into consideration before the notice is issued by the MCA. Yeah. So at the time of serving the notice or during inquiry, necessary documents can be sought, and in case of lapses are attributable, then the care must be taken that civil or criminal proceedings are not unnecessarily initiated against the independent directors and NEDs unless sufficient evidence exists. So basically, in the last point, they have mentioned that specific checklist or an SOP has been designed by the ministry for issuing such adjudication related notices. So that is one aspect to it. What I mean to say is that now, since the adjudication proceedings have started, relevant provisions have been notified, the Companies Act is from criminalized to it, we are going to decriminalization, and we have provisions about the adjudication proceedings. So all these will be issued in accordance with the provision. So whenever we have to defend our, you know, our client or company or director, we have to ensure that compliance with respect to section 149 subsection 12 is taken into consideration, and adequate documents records we have to prove that he was not part of this particular non-compliance. So ensure that compliance, because this is very, very critical. And in the present situation, practically in the COVID-19 situation, where things are practically changed, everything for every person, receiving a show cause notice from any statutory authority is, you know, is more taxing and more harassment, or, you know, a different mindset we go into. So this is very critical for us as compliance officers or corporate law professionals about this. So this circular, read with few other judgments, which I will share with you all separately, are quite relevant from the perspective of the liabilities of directors.
So the first question is, do company law and joint Hindu family law intersect in terms of family property dispute and joint Hindu family partition?
Yeah, okay. So yeah, got it. So if there is a dispute specifically in relation to the company matters, right? Just take an example. If HUF is a shareholder in a company, and there are certain disputes or the aspects, it is there in the, you can say, in the case of HUF, then the disputes in the HUF will be civil disputes. But if it is in relation to the membership, directorship of the person in the company, then it will be the dispute in relation to the company. So that that point of time, the NCLT will be the appropriate forum and not the civil dispute.
Are chartered accountants also officer in default for non-compliance of frauds in a balance sheet or irregular transfer of shares?
Yeah, actually it depends. Means now when we say chartered accountants, it will be either statutory auditor or a chartered accountant who is a officer in the company. So if he's a CFO, he may be part of the MP, and in case of irregularity, that could be the case which the participant is asking. if he is a part of the financial the finance team, and if the provisions of the officer in default are not triggered, then it will not be you can say relevant, or okay. He may not be an officer in default.
So if there is irregular transfer of shares of which the chartered accountant is also deemed to be a party, so presumably he works for the company, presumably he is an officer of the company, so would he also be termed as an officer in default?
So that's what, so if he's a KMP, key managerial personnel, whether he's a CFO or CEO or a manager, or he's having a separate designation, or he is appointed by the board, then he may fall under this particular non-compliance powers he has, and where he is actually in the hierarchy. Like in the finance team, not everybody is officer in default.
In case of persons who are defaulters in payment of bank loans, and if they are board of directors, what is the action taken against them by SEBI?
Yeah, so it may happen, it may happen that they can be defaulters, but for defaulter there is a separate provision. There is no specific action taken by the SEBI in this regard. Only thing, there will be certain restrictions on being a defaulter or a willful defaulter. But now I'm not understanding, this is his personal loan and he is not complied. If that is the case, practically SEBI is not bothered. Like, just to give an example, I have taken a personal loan, I have defaulted on my personal loan, I am a director on the listed entity, and listed entity is doing good, compliant, then I will not be, nothing will be taken against me, no action. But if the company itself is defaulting, even in that case, SEBI won't take an action unless and until I am party in the company operations and I do the non-compliances, then that would be the concern.
So basically, it stems from the fact that if you're in charge control of any operations of the company.
Yeah, exactly. So there is one phrase which I always refer is person in charge of management.
Sure. Like
in where you fall, then there is a possibility of liability. But again, the best counter to that is he gets he has a point of diligence. Once he proves his diligence, then he's out of that. So it is not that once you are liable, once you are in the hierarchy and you are liable, it is not like that. The law only expects that we are diligent in our work.
It pertains to rights of directors under IBC. Can a director ask for a copy of application filed by RP before NCLT for resolution plan/liquidation? And what is the provision if he's a shareholder too?
He can get a resolution, a plan or a petition copy, but for that the NCLT rules will apply. And under NCLT rules, any person can get a copy of the petition, or any person can get an access to the documents in relation to the petition or the ongoing matter.
So it doesn't. So it is not restricted to a director. It can include shareholder. Yeah. Can it include a third party too?
Yeah, there, it could be a third party that he can take. But I think so. In the recent times, NCLT has issued an internal circular saying that the person should be associated in that particular matter.
A notice of board meeting not sent by CS. What's the penalty?
Yeah, so now I think so. This is a question. I'm presuming it is a private company.
Yes, I would. So, because in public limited companies, they are bound to.
Yeah. I'm just referring to the provisions of Section 173, and Section 173 relates to the notice. So, whatever is the penal provision under 173 will be the provisions. Just to give a reference, it is 173 subsection 4. It says every officer of the company whose duty is to give notice under this section and who fails to do so will be liable for a penalty of 25,000 rupees.
LODR also applicable to private companies?
Yeah, actually, no, it is not applicable to private companies, but there are certain private companies whose debt securities are listed on the stock exchange and for which the SEBI LODR is applicable. Because there is no clarity, actually. Clarity means there is a process. Means I'll give you some background. under the Companies Amendment Bill 2020, there in the report there was a reference that there is a proposal to, you know, private companies whose debt securities are listed, they are proposing that the LODR will not be applicable. But for normal private companies, LODR is not applicable. As of now, for debt listed, it is applicable.
How far can the nominee directors be treated as independent directors?
Yeah, I think so. His question is not a legal question. His question is a very practical question, because nominee directors are, you can say, representing a particular interest or his own shareholders. So since he would be already representing an interest, he may not think it very objectively, which independent director is required to think from the perspective of the company. I'll just quickly come to section 149. 149 subsection 6, it says that independent director in relation to a company means a director other than managing director, whole-time director, nominee director. So actually, even legally, nominee director is not an independent director. Because of that point, as he is already interested in the company, means he is representing the interest of the company.
This kind of heavy penalties of directors are discouraging to entrepreneurs who may miss out on some plans. If TDS is not filed, this kind of heavy penalties of directors are discouraging to entrepreneurs who may miss out on some compliances as they are more focused towards business. If TDS is not filed on time or not complied with, do criminal implications arise on a director?
Yeah, if you see from at least what I have means, I'm not an expert in income tax, to be very upfront, and I would like to disclose that. But what I have read in the recent times, it is not that strict for the promoters or entrepreneurs, that it is not discouraging. But if this is being not deposited, not complied, and this goes for a very long time, then I have also read in the newspapers that certain actions have been taken against the person for non-depositing the TDS, and some criminal action is taken, but it is at a very latter point of time. It is not that we not comply now and action is taken immediately, but if that goes on, then there is, but this is based on what I've read in the newspapers, though I have not read the orders of the court on that aspect.
Sure.
Because I have read these two, means at least two orders or two newspaper articles on this point where TDS was not deposited, and but the objective of that person is not only that. His objective is not compliance oriented, but probably siphoning of funds. Therefore, that issue was.
Sir, please explain short case of Cyrus Mystery of TSPL NCLAT decision restoring Mystery, which was challenged in Supreme Court.
Yeah, actually, it would require a different session.
Then let's keep it for another session, sir.
Yeah, but since the matter is sub judice, as well as it has been appealed before the Supreme Court, Supreme Court has granted a stay. And based on what I read in the newspapers very recently, the hearings have started on this matter. I think so. Let's wait for the Supreme Court judgment. We can discuss that only.